डियर फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज एपिसोड नंबर 55 ऑफ द लिमिटेशन एक्ट. सेक्शन 21 इज बीइंग कंटिन्यू. आई विल साइट वन डिसीशन, ILR 1999 1 केरला 700. It is also reported in 1999 KHC 830. Mohanan Nair and others versus Ramakrishna Pillai. That was a suit to set aside an alienation. Suit was filed by the minor on attaining majority. Alienee is taking the defense that the properties had been further alienated, but they did not disclose the name of such alienee. Plaintiff took steps to implead the alienee after making enquiry, but that was beyond time. Whether Section 21 applies, proviso applies. Paragraph 6. In the written statement filed by defendants, they simply stated that they had transferred the property to another. That is, suit is filed for challenging the alienation by the de facto guardian or something like that. And on minor or attaining majority, he can do it within the period of limitation. And the alienee was impleaded. Alienee stated that he has further alienated. To whom it is not mentioned. If the name of that person is mentioned, the plaintiff could have very well impleaded him, but he did not, defendant did not do it. And simply stated in the written statement that they had transferred the property to another. They deliberately omitted to mention the name of the alienee. The plaintiffs in their application for impleading have stated that on the written statement being filed and on their obtaining a copy of the written statement, they had to make enquiries and they could make the application for impleading defendant number 5 as a party only after obtaining a registration copy of the document executed by defendants 1 to 3. The circumstances clearly indicate that the alienation by defendants 1 to 3 itself was only just 2 months prior to the institution of the suit. Under such circumstances, it is clear that this was a case of bona fide omission on the part of the plaintiffs to implead defendant number 5 when they instituted the suit originally on such and such date. In the circumstance of the case, it is clear that the proviso to Section 21 of the Limitation Act is attracted. The facts of the present case bear considerable similarity to the facts of the case decided by the Supreme Court in the decision in Munshi Ram versus Nani Ram, which we cited, AER 1983 Supreme Court 271. This decision of the Kerala High Court is by Justice P.K. Balasubramanian. Next is ILR 1993 2 Kerala 166. Parallel citation 1992 2 KLT Kerala Law Times 785. That is also by Justice Balasubramanian. Name of the case is Karunagara Pisharadi versus Raman. In that case, it is a question of Order 1, Rule 10 vis-a-vis Section 21. And in paragraph 8, it is a long paragraph. Nevertheless, I propose to read it carefully. Listen carefully, you will get so many things, which even if I state, that will not have that much effect. Order 1, Rule 10, 5 of the Code of Civil Procedure, which I read to you in the previous episode, that it will take effect from the date when the summons was received by the newly added parties. Order 1, Rule 10.5 of the Code of Civil Procedure contemplates cases where this is a rare case where this question which is decided here was not seen decided anywhere else. Order 1, Rule 10.5 of the Code contemplates a cases where a person is added as a defendant in a suit which is already pending. It provides that subject to the provisions of Section 21 of the Limitation Act, the proceedings as against any person added as a defendant shall be deemed to have begun only on the service of summons. Order 1, Rule 10.5 in terms do not apply to addition of a plaintiff. See, Order 1, Rule 10.5 in terms does not apply to addition of a plaintiff. It applies only to addition of defendant. But Order 1, Rule 10.1 CPC provides that where the suit is instituted in the name of a plaintiff and it is doubtful whether it has been instituted in the name of the right plaintiff, the court may at any stage of the suit, if satisfied that the suit has been instituted through a bona fide mistake and it is necessary for the determination of the real matter in dispute, so as to order any other person to be substituted or added as a plaintiff, upon such terms the court thinks just. Order 1, Rule 10, 1 and 2. 1 speaks only of plaintiff. 2, subrule 2, which includes a suo motu power, speaks of plaintiff as well as defendant. Subrule 5, it is noted by in this decision, does not apply to, on the wording, does not apply to plaintiff. And defendant is impleaded and he shall be deemed to be impleaded when he receives. Subject to the provisions of the Indian Limitation Act 22, now it is 21, the proceedings against any person added as a defendant shall be deemed to have begun only on the service of summons. That applies only to defendants. Whereas Order 1, Rule 10.1 speaks of only the plaintiff. Order 1, Rule 10.2 speaks of plaintiff as well as defendant, whether as plaintiff or defendant. Rule 10.1, only plaintiff. Then the question is whether 10.5, Rule 10.5 of Order 1, whether it can be applied to the plaintiff also, or whether Order 21, Section 21 being applicable, there is no difference whether it is a plaintiff or a defendant. What is the position vis-a-vis Order 1, Rule 10? This is the question which is considered. I will continue to read. It is interesting to note that Order 1, Rule 10.5 does not deal with the effect of subsequent impleading of a plaintiff in the suit. But coming to Section 21 of the Limitation Act, it comprehends within its scope the addition of a new plaintiff or a new defendant. And Section 21.1 of the Limitation Act provides that the suit as regards the newly added plaintiff or defendant shall be deemed to have been instituted when he was so made a party. The normal effect of reading Order 1, Rule 10.1 CPC and Section 21 of the Limitation Act is to be postulated that the case of addition of a new plaintiff, the suit must be deemed to commence only when he was so impleaded. This position emerges notwithstanding the fact that Order 1, Rule 10.5 speaks only of the addition of a defendant when it refers to Section 21 of the Limitation Act. It appears to me that the power conferred on the court under Order 1, Rule 10.1 CPC for impleading an additional plaintiff has nothing to do with the effect of that impleading in so far as it relates to the question of limitation to be determined under the Indian Limitation Act. See, it appears to me that the power conferred on the court under Order 1, Rule 10.1 CPC for impleading an additional plaintiff has nothing to do with the effect of that impleading in so far as it relates to the question of limitation to be determined under the Indian Limitation Act. so considered, Section 21(1) of the Limitation Act specifically provides that insofar as a newly added plaintiff is concerned, the suit will be deemed to have been filed only when he was made a party to the suit. But this provision in Section 21(1) of the Limitation Act is circumscribed by a power vested in the court to regard the suit having been filed in favor of the newly added plaintiff from the day of its original institution in the name of the wrong plaintiff. This power is conferred by the proviso to Section 21(1) of the Limitation Act, and it calls for the satisfaction of the court that the omission to implead a new plaintiff was bona fide or due to a mistake made in good faith. This entails an inquiry as to whether the omission to implead originally was due to a bona fide mistake or omission. Next is AER 1992 Kerala 390, same as 1992 2KLT 260. Name of the case, Madhavi Amma versus Indu Shekharan. A person was omitted to be implicated in the appeal. It is always safe that all the parties in the original suit are made parties in the appeal, unless by the decree any one of them is exonerated from the liability and the appellant does not challenge that exoneration. Otherwise, it is always safe to implead. But some lawyers ask a question: why should I implead that person also? I am not asking any relief against him. But sometimes it may turn out that, for example, Order 41, Rule 33, etc., may arise in certain cases, and it may come abruptly during the course of arguments in the appeal. Therefore, always it is better that all the parties in the suit are made parties in the appeal, whether as appellant or as respondent. The other thing will be very dangerous. Sometimes it may prove to be fatal. But at the same time, a defendant who is exonerated by the trial court cannot be roped in the appeal unless you challenge that finding, the appellant challenges that finding, that he should not have been exonerated. Challenges the finding that he is not liable. So in this case, that was the question. A party was not made a party in the appeal. A party to the suit was not made in the party in the appeal. Then a question arose. He died subsequently. Then what happens is the question. In paragraph 16, legal representatives whether can be brought on record under Order 41, Rule 20. With regard to Section 21 of the Limitation Act, it was held. Order 41, Rule 20. I'm sorry. Where it appears to the court at the hearing that a person who was a party to the suit in the court from whose decree the appeal is preferred, but who has not been made a party to the appeal, is interested in the result of the appeal, the court may adjourn the hearing to a future date to be fixed by the court and direct that such person be made a respondent. See, this specific situation is dealt with in Rule 20 of Order 41. So, this question is considered in paragraph 16. There was a power failure. Yes, this approach, paragraph 16, This approach is also supported by the proviso to Section 21 of the Limitation Act, 1963, read with Order 1, Rule 10.5 of the CPC, which gives a discretion to the court while impleading a party to treat the party as having been impleaded within the period of limitation, notwithstanding the fact that the real impleading is done beyond the period of limitation. The object and reasons of the insertion of the proviso to Section 21 of the Limitation Act says that it is done so that an omission to implead a person owing to a bona fide mistake does not deprive a person of his rights against that person if the court is satisfied in that behalf. The developing concept of justice. See, please note this. This is also a judgment by division bench, judgment by Justice Balasubramanian. The developing concept of justice is to give the courts wide powers to get over procedural bottlenecks so as to enable the court to do real justice between the parties in a cause. This broader approach would certainly be stultified by putting undue restrictions on the power of the appellate court to implead the absolutely necessary parties so as to enable to decide the cause on the merits. See, this decision stands out. The principles behind the insertion of the proviso, we saw one decision of the Supreme Court, but this point has not been mentioned there. So this is mentioned in the decision of the division bench, authored by Justice Balasubramanian. This concept of justice, developing concept of justice. See, rigid views, there are several types of views. Some are rigid, some are liberal. In actual life also, some are rigid, some are liberal. When it comes to the courts also, it being manned by human beings, it may happen. It may happen. But there is the trend that nothing can be done, all these things, say they entangle everything in procedural hazards and deny justice to a party. That is not good. Over the years, I have heard a question from court, subordinate courts. How can it be done when an application is filed? Question is, how can it be done? And the lawyer on the other side also, how can it be? See, too rigid a view. I will say, but this is quite personal, not based on any study, not based on any settled law. This is my personal view. I say, ask that question the other way about. How can it be done? I always say to the law students, to the lawyers, and to the young judicial officers, you ask this question this way, why can't it be done? Is there a bar? Or is it immoral, illegal, otherwise unjust, unreasonable? No. Then why not? Why Section 151 is there in the CPC, where a similar provision is there, not there in the CRPC, giving power to the subordinate courts? I always stand for this question. You are asking, how can it be? I put the question the other way about, why can't it be? So if you ask that question, you correct that question in this way, you will get the answer, so long as it is not prohibited under any of the provisions of the CPC or any other statute, either procedural or substantive. And so far as it is not immoral, illegal, unreasonable, unjust, what prevents you from exercising your power under Section 151 in the appropriate cases? and do justice to the parties. Parties are craving for justice. When you are satisfied that justice should be done, and if you do it, and that will be the justice in the case, but you find that I am powerless, that is not good. In section 21, Justice Balasubramaniam in that decision said that the developing concept of justice, the developing concept of justice is to give the courts wider powers to get over the procedural bottlenecks so as to enable the court to do real justice between the parties in the cause. So that should be the view. When parties approach the court, it is not to deny them the relief on some technical, grounds. There are experts in that, lawyers as well as judges. How to deny relief? How to not to exercise your jurisdiction? They are well versed in it. Yes. Now we go to, we have completed section 21. Now we go to section 22. 21 I dealt with elaborately because it is a question of day-to-day application. If you go to civil court every day, it happens. Impleading of parties, making them omitted parties, adding them, representative suits, or originally not a representative suit, but making a representative suit. All those things. So all these questions may arise for considerations, therefore you must be well versed in that. Now we go to section 22. Continuing breaches and torts. Continuing breaches and torts. In the case of a continuing breach of contract, or in the case of a continuing tort, a fresh period of limitation begins to run at every moment of the time during which the breach or the tort, as the case may be, continues. I will read once again. There is no difficulty in understanding. In the case of a continuing breach of contract, that is one thing, breach of contract. But that breach is continuous breach. Or in the case of a continuing tort, a wrongful act which amounts to a tortious liability, creates a tortious liability. It is continuing in nature. You discharge foul water into the neighbor's compound, it continues. Every day, foul water from a factory, it is a continuous act. In the case of a continuing breach of contract, or in the case of a continuing tort, a fresh period of limitation begins to run at every moment of the time during which the breach or the tort, as the case may be, continues. Now we will see some of the decisions under section 22. Not very much. This is not a day-to-day application in the court, but rarely it applies. 2000, please note, 2011 2 SCC 682. Corresponding AER, 2011, Supreme Court, 952, Hariram versus Jyoti Prasad and another. Hariram versus Jyoti Prasad and another. Encroachment on public street. Whether it is continuous tort, is the question. Paragraph 17 and 18. Paragraph 17 I will read, and paragraph 18 also, two short paragraphs. The High Court, after considering the aforesaid plea, held that the suit cannot be said to be barred by limitation, as an encroachment on public street is a continuing wrong, and therefore there exists a continuing cause of action. The records disclose that initially a complaint under section 133 CRPC was filed, which was pursued with all sincerity up to the High Court, but the High Court held that the dispute between the parties could be better resolved if a proper civil suit is filed, and when the evidence is led with regard to the disputed questions of fact, we find from the records that immediately thereafter the aforesaid suit was filed seeking issuance of a mandatory injunction. In view of the aforesaid facts, and also in view of the fact that encroachment on public street is by any person is a continuing cause of action, we find no merits in the said contention. By the time the suit is filed, it was barred by limitation, going by the Limitation Act schedule. But he had initiated a proceeding under section 133 CRPC, and when it came to the High Court, the High Court said that there are disputed questions of fact, it is always better that these things are resolved in a civil suit. Immediately a civil suit was filed. Then the other side raised an argument that it is barred by limitation. Then the reply is, it is a continuing wrong, and therefore every moment the cause of action arises, and therefore the suit is not barred. Para 18, any act of encroachment is a wrong committed by the doer. Such an encroachment, when made to a public property, like encroachment to public road, would be a graver wrong. As such, wrong prejudicially affects a number of people, and therefore it is a public wrong. So long as any obstruction or obstacle is created to free and unhindered access and movement on the road, the wrongful act continues, thereby preventing the persons to use the public road freely and unhindered. Therefore, that being a continuing source of wrong and injury, cause of action is created so long as such injury continues, and so long as the doer is responsible for causing such injury. We will see in the next episode. Thank you.